Welcome to Washington Street United Methodist Church, a church with heart in the heart of the city of Columbia, South Carolina. I'm truly glad that you're joining us today for worship and that you're going to be a part of this experience of gathering in the name of Christ, even though we are gathering in different places. As many of you are aware, we have had a survey recently about outdoor worship and in-person worship in the sanctuary. We will be able to calculate those results very soon and be making plans for the future when we can gather together in safety. Until then, I hope you will continue to join us worshiping each Sunday here on our virtual platform at wsmethodist.org. You can go there to find out about our Sunday school. You can go there to find out about our youth activities, our children's ministries, and all the ways in which we connect with the community here at Washington Street United Methodist Church. In May, we were a part of a recognition of foster care families, and we have a guest with us here today to make a presentation to our church community. Kathy James is here with us. Kathy, thank you for coming today.
Thank you so much for having me. It is a joy to be with you. I want to share with you that across the nation, as many as half of foster parents who hear the call to be foster parents and do the work to become licensed end up leaving in the first year because they feel isolated and alone. And in May, y'all offered from your heart gifts of vegetable boxes and staple goods that you shared with, I want to say, about 20 of our foster families, and you delivered them. And it was a tremendous gift. So I want to present this certificate of appreciation to Washington Street United Methodist Church in grateful recognition of your loving support of Epworth foster families. It is a joy to be in partnership in ministry with you, and I look forward to future opportunities to connect you with foster families in our community. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Kathy, and thank you for joining us in this time. And now, wherever you may be, I invite you to light a candle and to join me in this time of worship. In the midst of the desert heat, God heard the cries of the people. Help us, Lord. Please help us. Manna was given and water gushed forth from a rock. Lord, have mercy upon us. In the midst of the deserts of fear and frustration, God will provide for our needs. Lord, come to us and heal us. Amen.
come from wilderness and wandering here in truth, we will be fed. You that yearn for days of fullness, all around us is our food. Taste and see the grace eternal, taste and see that God is good. All who hunger, never strangers, seekers be a welcome guest. Come from restlessness and roaming, here in joy we keep the feast. We that once were lost and scattered, in communion's love have stood. Taste and see the grace eternal, taste and see that God is good.
Please join me for the opening prayer. O God, from your providing hand, even the dissatisfied and grumbling receive what they need for their lives. Teach us your way of justice and lead us to practice your generosity, so that we may live a life worthy of the gospel made known through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. And now, with the confidence of children of God, let us join together and affirm our faith using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
My dear. The scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Exodus, chapter 16, verses 2 through 15. Hear now the word of the Lord. The whole congregation of the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread. For you have brought us out into the wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I'm going to rain bread from heaven for you, and each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. In that way I will test them, whether they will follow my instruction or not. On the sixth day, when they prepare for what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather on other days." So Moses and Aaron said to all the Israelites, "In the evening you shall know that it was the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt. And in the morning you shall see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard your complaining against the Lord. For what are we that you complain against us?" And Moses said, "When the Lord gives you meat to eat in the evening and your fill of bread in the morning, because the Lord has heard the complaining that you utter against him, what are we? Your complaining is not against us, but against the Lord." Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole congregation of the Israelites, 'Draw near to the Lord, for he has heard your complaining.'" And as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the Israelites, they looked toward the wilderness, and the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. The Lord spoke to Moses and said, "I have heard the complaining of the Israelites. Say to them, 'At twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall have your fill of bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God.' In the evening quail came up and covered the camp, and in the morning there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a fine flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, 'What is it?' For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, 'It is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat.'" This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. In this passage, the Israelites are having trust issues. They are in the wilderness, the desert, because God has just rescued them from bondage in Egypt after a series of 10 plagues. It took 10 plagues sent by God for Pharaoh to decide to let his slave labor force go. But almost as soon as he had made that decision, he changed his mind as he saw all those laborers walking away. So he gathered his army and chased them and cornered them against the Red Sea. With their backs to the Red Sea, God saved them by parting the Red Sea, allowing the Israelites to walk through on dry land. And then when the Egyptians tried to follow, the water came crashing in on them and the Egyptian army drowned. After that, Moses started to lead them through the wilderness, and they came to Marah. And at Marah, there was no clean water to drink. It was bitter, it was undrinkable. And so they complained, and God told Moses to throw a stick into the water, and the water became clean, and they were able to drink it. And now here they are, further in the wilderness, and they're facing starvation. There's nothing to eat for this group of people. And many commentators think that the group of Israelites numbered over 2 million people. So it's understandable that the Israelites had trust issues. How could God provide for that many people in the middle of the wilderness? So just as they had with their backs against the Red Sea, and just as they had at Marah, they grumbled. They complained to Moses and Aaron that they were going to starve to death in the middle of the wilderness. The Israelites had trust issues. They didn't trust Moses and Aaron, their earthly leaders, and they didn't trust God, their ultimate leader. Even based on the evidence of past rescue and past provision that hadn't occurred all that long before, they had a hard time believing that God was going to still provide for them. How could God feed such a big group? It didn't seem possible. I'll admit it, I have trust issues too. I've been hurt by people I love, been let down, and when that happens to me, I have a hard time trusting that person again, but I also have a hard time trusting other people because I don't want to put myself in the position of being hurt. Unfortunately, my trust issues with people also extend to my relationship with God sometimes. Even though God has been very, very good to me and has always provided what I needed and never let me down, I sometimes wonder if God's going to be with me in the crisis of the moment, or if whatever I'm going through even merits divine attention. Do you have trust issues too? When you find yourself in the wilderness, not knowing where to go or what to do, after the phone call from the doctor with the diagnosis, or after getting a email from your boss that says you won't have a job 2 weeks from now, or being stuck in the middle of a seemingly never-ending pandemic, do you sometimes doubt that God is with you in the moment, in this crisis? Do you trust God to be there for you and provide what you need? Now, we are all worried about the state of our country with murders and protests and riots, floods, wildfires, and a whole bunch of hurricanes. Okay. Where is God in all this turmoil and uncertainty? Does God still provide when the world feels like it's falling apart? When you look around, it seems like our problems are too big to solve. Just like the Israelites thought when they were in the middle of the wilderness with no source of food. But the Israelites learned that God was with them in the middle of the wilderness. And we can learn that too. When the Israelites complained to Moses about the lack of food, Moses took their complaint to God, and God provided. The Lord told Moses to tell the people, "I am going to rain bread from heaven for you." And God did. God sent manna every morning that they were to gather. They were to gather enough for that one day, except on the sixth day, when they were to gather enough manna for 2 days' worth so that they could rest on the seventh. Now, with the manna, God is providing what the Israelites desperately needed, food, and what they had complained about and asked for. But God is also providing a day of rest, something that these former slaves were not acquainted with and wouldn't have even thought to ask for. God knew their need, even though they didn't ask. Now, God chose to have them collect manna every day because God was continuing to demonstrate that God is trustworthy and faithful. And God did provide every day for what ended up being 40 years of wandering in the wilderness. During their time in the wilderness, the Israelites learned that God is not like fallible human beings. When God makes a promise, God keeps it. This is good news for us today because we're in the middle of a lot of crises. It's comforting to know that we can trust God to be with us in our problems and to provide for us and never leave us. Now, God doesn't always take away our problems. You're probably well aware of that. But God does promise to be with us in the midst of them, accompanying us, giving us comfort, peace, and sometimes even joy in the midst of our problems. As the Lord says in Isaiah 43, verses 1 and 2, "Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flames will not overwhelm you." What comfort these words can give us. But do we have examples from our lives that show God's faithfulness? I do, and I hope you do too. But I want to share a story that I heard on the radio years ago about Britt Nicole, who is a Christian singer-songwriter. And she learned how to rely on God's love and trust and trust in God's faithfulness when she was only 7 years old and her parents were going through a painful divorce. During this difficult time, she found comfort from the Lord in the midst of her sorrow and knew that God was with her, even though her parents still got that divorce. She said that despite the pain she felt seeing her family get torn apart, she knew God was with her, and God's love is what helped her get over her sorrow and heartache. Later, God used the verse from 1 Corinthians 28:20, which says, "Be strong and courageous and do the work. Don't be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord God, my God, is with you. He will not fail you or forsake you," to reassure her. It's a reminder to her that God will never leave her side, that God is always with her. She even wrote a song entitled All This Time about God's faithfulness. Listen now to some of the lyrics. "I remember the moment, I remember the pain. I was only a girl, but I grew up that day. Tears were falling, I know you saw me. Hiding there in my bedroom, all alone. I was doing my best, trying to be strong. No one to turn to. That's when I met you. All this time, from the first tear cried to today's sunrise, and every single moment between, you were there. You were always there. It was you and I. You've been walking with me all this time. Ever since that day, it's been clear to me that no matter what comes, you will never leave. I know you're for me and you're restoring every heartache and failure, every broken dream. You're the God who sees, the God who rescued me." We all need this type of trust in God, to know that God is with us even in our darkest times and will never leave us. This type of trust, this faith, must be developed. It doesn't just magically appear. Rather, it grows as we cultivate a relationship with God. And we cultivate a relationship with God just like any other relationship, by spending time with God in prayer, talking to God, and also by reading our Bible, where we learn more and more about God and God's character. And as we read the Bible more, we, like Britt, will find verses that speak to us personally and show and remind us of God's faithfulness and trustworthiness. We will know that God loves us so much that God has numbered the hairs on our head and has our names engraved on the palm of God's hands. We will understand that we can turn to God even with our complaints, our heartaches, our broken dreams, our doubts, and our fears, and God will be there for us and with us no matter how many times we call out for help. It all sounds easy, but it can be hard to trust God this much. When our problems are big and scary, we can have trust issues, because it takes a lot of trust, a lot of faith, to think that God will provide when our problems seem insurmountable, or when our problems seem so small that we wonder if God's paying attention. So we have to practice trusting God. And the best way to practice is with the little things. Following God as God leads and directs us in how we spend our time or our money. This develops our trust muscle as we see God's faithfulness to us. As we get to know God better and better and trust God more and more, we will be able, when times are hard, to cling to the fact that God is with us and God will never leave us or forsake us. We will know in our very inner being that God is with us in the midst of struggles, even if God doesn't fix the problem that we're going through, because we will recognize God's comfort and support in the midst of our troubles. We will be able to trust that the God who became human to show us the full extent of divine love, the God who was willing to go to the cross to prove that love, and who is well acquainted with suffering and sorrow, will be with us in our troubles and will never leave us or forsake us. Thanks be to God.
Pues si vivimos, para Él vivimos, y si morimos, para Él morimos, sea que vivamos o que muramos, somos el Señor, somos el Señor. Mid times of sorrow and in times of pain, when sensing beauty or in love's embrace, whether we suffer or sing rejoicing, somos el Señor, somos el Señor. Across the wide world we shall always find those who are crying with no peace of mind. But when we help them, or when we feed them, somos el Señor, somos el Señor, somos el Señor, somos el Señor.
Join me now in the prayer of confession. O God, source of all that makes life possible, giver of all that makes life good, we gather to give you our thanks, yet we confess that we have often failed to live our thankfulness. What we have, we take for granted, and we grumble about what we lack. We have squandered your bounty with little thought of those who will come after us. We are more troubled by the few that have more than by the many who have less. Forgive us, O God, and this time of worship accept our thanksgiving, and teach us to make gratitude and sharing our way of life through the grace of Jesus Christ. Amen. And now, with the confidence of children of God, let us join together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Truly it is God who saves me. I will trust in him and not be afraid. For the Lord is my stronghold and my sure defense, and he will be my Savior. Therefore you shall draw water with rejoicing from the springs of salvation. And on that day you shall say, give thanks to the Lord and call upon his name. Surely it is God who saves me. I will trust in him and not be afraid. For the Lord is my stronghold and my sure defense, and he will be my Savior. Make his deeds known among the peoples. See that they remember that his name is exalted. Sing the praises of the Lord, for he has done great things, and this is known in all the world. Surely it is God who saves me. I will trust him and not be afraid. For the Lord is my stronghold and my sure defense, and he will be my Savior. Cry aloud, inhabitants of Zion, bring out your joy. For the great one in the midst of you is the Holy One of Israel. Surely it is God who saves me. I will trust in him and not be afraid. For the Lord is my stronghold and my sure defense, and he will be my Savior.
And now, go out into the world knowing that God sees you, God knows what you're going through, and God will be with you always. In the name of God, the Creator, God the Sustainer, and God the Redeemer. Amen.